Dr. Trehan. It's
Thank
really
you.
beautiful to reconnect with you. I know we met back in 2007 at that time, or six, I think at that time, the whole Medicity was in conception stage, and you did discuss about that plan, and we did reveal it to our audience at that point. And look at this, now we are in 2017, and I'm visiting here, Medicity at Medanta, and it's a gorgeous complex. So, so proud of you to have realized your dreams and become a very prominent figure in changing people's life.
Thank you for coming back again, because it's 10 years, I didn't realize, you still look the same, so until you mentioned the date, I wouldn't even imagine it was that long ago, but then that's what life is like on a daily basis. Yeah. So, you know, and you have, this is your third book, you just told me about that, that's great, my compliments for that. So, yes, it is, you can say, luck and divine intervention that we have Medanta, but the whole idea, as we discussed then, was to create one of those institutions in this part of the world which would be likened to the Harvards and the Mayos and the Clevelands, because that was missing here. And so that was the idea that we were pursuing, and fortunately those three things that we thought were essential for creating that platform. One was, of course, the infrastructure which you saw coming up, but now, you know, it took shape. Then the technology, and technology, as you can see, I think with confidence we can say that we have technology here which very few people in the world have. So that's a nice thing to have happened. And then the third thing was to get the best of kind of different specialties on the same platform. So that's also happened. So that means now we are in our seventh year, and a lot has happened in the meantime. And we have basically, you know, the difference between a regular healthcare facility or a hospital and what is represented by the frontier institutions is threefold. One is they do provide the best of care. So I think we can easily, I mean, I feel we have accomplished that. The second is the fact that it becomes a last stop, because of the fact that there is convergence of super specialists of the same caliber on the same platform. So I'll give you an example how this worked. I mean, it's a recent example, so I'll give it to you. There's a gentleman who had a cervical spine problem. A neurosurgeon, a very well accomplished neurosurgeon, put an anterior metal plate to support the spine. Now, unfortunately, that plate eroded through the esophagus. And it, you could actually see it on endoscopy, and it was giving him pain like you would not believe. He couldn't swallow. He was like, he lost 18 kilos. So he's just miserable. And he'd been all over the place, including overseas. And everybody felt that it was a, quite a challenge to actually make it heal because of the fact. So through a common friend, the problem came to us. And what I did was I assembled five specialists on the same table along with the patient, and we reviewed the whole thing. And all five of them understood collectively they could actually do it. So there was, of course, the gastroenterologist who knew exactly the position and all that. Then there was this head and neck surgeon who's used to operate on the most complicated cancer patients in the in that region. Then there was the gastroenterology, a gastroenterology surgeon who was, you know, who does all these esophageal work all day kind of thing. So that was, he was there. Then the neurosurgeon was there, who was supposed to remove the plate and stabilize. So he was there. And then there was the plastic and reconstructive surgeon who actually was there if required to reconstruct and rotate flaps to reinforce the gap, because it's a huge gap. So they, all five of them worked together. And it, fortunately, because of the planning, it went like clockwork. And the patient went home 10 days later, and he just came about 2 weeks after that to thank all of us. And he's put on 5 kilos. He's just, he said, my, I can't stop eating because I've been missing for 6 months and I was starving. And so, you know, collectively, many situations like this we deal with, And like I, you know, while I was in New York, I mean, we saw it, you know, how collective work works.
Yes, yes.
And this actually conceptually has worked. So this is great. And then, of course, research, frontier research.
Yes, yes.
That was the other. So we have done a lot of work, especially on integrating Ayurveda and modern medicine together. We've had some great success in cancer patients, in patients with neurological problems, strokes and stuff like that, their rehabilitation. So things are moving,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So like I said, it must be divine intervention, because it was just an idea, and fortunately so far, it's working well.
Yeah, and it's all about connecting the dots. I think last time when we were discussing, this is what you said, that you want to provide a comprehensive platform where at one center every approach could be used to cure.
Yeah, because I understood that, because when I first came back from the US, I built Escorts Heart Institute.
Yes.
It was a single super specialty institute,
right,
which was also a great idea. But then I realized the gaps,
right,
that you couldn't have the best of everybody there, and no disease is in isolation all the time.
Yes.
So now we, I think progressively we've become the last stop, which is a nice thing, because that's what our purpose was.
Yes, yes. So Dr. Trehan, as you know, that Roshni Media is all about, our mission statement is about creating diversity awareness globally. And we have succeeded in, you know, coming up with our awards and our own way to let the whole world know that it's not just one community, and community is positive when everyone is diverse, comes through. What would be your opinion on women empowerment, global awareness of it?
See, you know, if you historically look at it.
Yes.
It all started with, I think, with division of labor, that one takes care of one and the other, but the short end of the stick was for the women.
Yes.
Because they were homemakers, they were rearing the family, which is admirable, actually. I have the highest respect for that.
For, yeah.
But at the same time, with that, because of their not being connected to economic activity,
right,
the appreciation was not there.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. So, if you remember, I mean, 30 years ago or so, maybe a little longer, the whole women's liberation movement happened.
Yes.
Because they were like being downtrodden, you could say,
yes,
for admirable work they were doing. So, so I'm glad that happened, that you say, okay, there is value to what they are doing.
Mm-hmm.
If they are going to be supporting the family, it's not, you know, men always had this idea that I'm the frontier guy, I'll go hunt and bring the food home. Along with that went a lot of territory.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And
yes.
So I think there was an imbalance which actually took a sort of long time to reach the stage.
Okay.
Because first, you know, even women, I think were the even sufferers in the early days of women's liberation, because, you know, the movement happened and they had to do double the work and
yes,
to cope, and
yeah,
then there was a lot of push back, and you know, all that stuff happened.
No,
but I'm glad it survived all that.
Yes, right.
And today we can be rightfully proud that women are actually incrementally being appreciated. I mean, now the latest thing is, it used to be, if you want to get something done, give it to a man. I mean, it's the reverse now. I trust.
That's true.
I'm in my own office, surrounded by three women who actually run my life.
Yes, yes.
So I'm saying that there is a, you can say, anybody who's deprived of opportunity cannot be measured.
Exactly.
How do you measure? You just
yes,
say, you know, you're a homebody, you just stay at home and cook and clean. I mean, that's bad.
Yes,
I think.
Yeah.
If the potential, and there's nothing wrong with it.
No.
But if the potential exists for the human mind, whether it's male or female, to do things which are participative at the same level in society as everybody else,
yes,
that opportunity should be there, no question.
Absolutely.
And like I said, there comes a time in the life of a homemaker where you're needed for the children.
Yes.
You're needed not so much to cook for the husband, but to rear
family,
the children.
Yes.
Because it does happen, you know, disconnected families have downstream many problems also.
Yes, yes.
So,
yeah.
I think that balance, that work-life balance, home-life balance, is a very delicate thing. So you can only say, that you can admire women for, because they are much stronger. Yes. Actually, they are much stronger than men are.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And the only time you see weakness is when they're so downtrodden that their spirit has been beaten out of them.
Yes, right.
So I think if you appreciate all that, you're aware of it, and you actually incrementally, they're great partners.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
I mean, also they add a lot of sensitivity to the environment.
Yes.
You know, otherwise it's a rough world.
Yes.
You know.
That's true.
So I admire the fact that they have come into their own, and they're coming, and if you look at us, there's reverse gender,
yeah.
Bias here, because we have 3,000 nurses.
Yes.
So we are the minority.
Yes.
That's good. And it's very good.
Yeah. So, you know, you have a lot of followers, and you are a great inspirational role model for many, many, many upcoming younger generation. What would be your message to those who really want to strive to become who you are?
Well, I don't know about that follower part, whether it's true or not, but
it is true.
Anyway, when you reflect back,
yes,
it just gives you, I mean, gray hair just gives you some thoughts which you can share.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which you can share. You know, I'll tell you one belief that I have. If you look at when we were growing up, in the old times, there was just 5-6 professions.
Yes.
Life has come full circle in the meantime.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So then there was the baby boomers, and now the millennials.
Yes.
These are words very well chosen to describe the environment, basically.
Yes.
This is the environment, basically,
yes.
Right? That was the need then. This is the need now.
Right.
Okay. So, but in this changing scenario, or the sea of, you know, things that you could do, many factors have come in also.
Mm-hmm.
And the factors but what the most sort of sought after, in my opinion, is right now the end economic result.
Mm-hmm.
Because economics has taken, from the mid 80s onwards, it became the me generation.
Right. Yes.
Before that, we enjoyed about 15 years, maybe more, of the counterculture.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the reaction of the world, or it actually started in the US, the wars and all that, people reacted, right?
Right.
So
yeah.
The peace,
yes,
movement started, rock concert,
culture,
you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah,
so these are the turning point in, mm-hmm, society, where people actually try to put in perspective what is the role of money and what is the role of human value,
mm-hmm,
and why are we actually pursuing some reckless activity which is destroying the world. But then, so there was a very nice period, and then it actually exploded again.
Mm-hmm.
Then, you know, all the Middle East, this, you know, stuff happened, and people became more and more inward looking for that, what's in it for me.
Yes, that's true.
You know. So in that, you know, sort of cloud that is around us right now, we have to sift through what do you really want to accomplish in life. I'll tell you one thing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there is a bigger tragedy in life than to wake up in the morning and say, I hate to go to work.
To go to work, right. That's
true. So if you're in the wrong,
yes,
by putting in so much effort, you find yourself in the wrong profession.
Mm-hmm.
That's upsetting. That's unsettling.
Yes, yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, because then you're out of sync.
Absolutely.
So be careful when you are actually looking at which stream you want to follow. That you should, one thing important is your natural talent.
Right.
Because today is a very competitive world.
Mm-hmm.
And mediocrity is a shameful state,
yes,
because you're not feeling good.
Correct.
So mediocrity comes from the fact that many factors. Either you don't care and you're just happy just being, nothing wrong with that.
Mm-hmm.
If you're happy being mediocre, that's great. But to be in conflict, to be mediocre and wanting to be the top of the file, then becomes
true.
Then becomes the problem. So I think the best chance you have in life of doing, accomplishing, if you are, that's in your DNA, to want to be something, choose your profession well. Because your natural talent will help you. It's not enough alone. Talent itself will not, can be misleading. But at the same time, it is a very essential ingredient to your success. Mm-hmm. And some of it is the time warp. So, if you look at blocks of time, certain professions then reach their peak.
Right. Yes.
Medicine is one of those periods, the golden period of, for doctors, you can say.
Yes.
I mean, as far as the glory was concerned, the amount of money they were rewarded with was huge. Then, you know, the whole thing came, how to provide better care to the larger masses at an affordable cost. It's a challenge around the world. It's not
yes,
like it.
No.
But in the meantime, readjustment took place about how much people say a doctor is supposed to be. All born millionaires? Right?
Yeah.
Or is it like, is it a birthright or is it... But the whole first thing is that you must provide succor to the society. And then if you happen to make money, you may happen to make money. Nothing wrong with
right,
that. You
right.
should make money.
Yes.
And then you saw that the traditional engineer became industry was growing, that you know, manufacturing, this, that, the whole engine was heated up and engineers became greatly in demand. Then that generation is also now over because then it became IT engineering. And the ones who could not transform were too late for them.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Right? So it works in blocks. So you have to renew yourself on a daily basis.
Yes.
And that's one thing, the only picture that is in my office is that of Dr. Spencer, Frank Spencer, who was my professional guru. And I learned from him this fact. He used to say that very clearly, if you're standing still, you're going backwards. And if you're not better today than yesterday, then you wasted 24 hours. So if you incorporate in your life the fact that nothing lasts forever. World is in transformation. World is like a river which keeps flowing. If you don't flow with it,
yes,
you will get lost. So that's the whole key one must bring into natural talent and what actually you do with it.
Yes, yes.
And how you can incorporate it into
yes.
what... Because if you love your work, if you have that passion
yes.
for it, you will, that's the best chance you'll have to get to be the best. And if you're the best, then you don't have to worry about anything
yeah.
else. You know,
yes.
this is what I'm trying
yeah.
to say.
And work doesn't seem like work if you really have a passion for
exactly.
it.
That's exactly. I mean, I give my own example. I mean, somehow I've landed up. I love this. I work 12, 14 hours a day, but then people say, you know, you better slow down. But I said, look, yes, you do at the end of the day feel the effect of like feel a little tired, but you've had so much fun doing it
yes.
that you just want
doesn't
to read.
Feel.
Yeah, go to sleep, get your 6 hours, and then back again.
Yes.
I mean, that's no regrets. Yeah, so I think that is the message I could give you, in the sense that have the perspective. Now you look at India today.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we are now 75 years old in our
right.
after our independence. Okay. There are many things that have been beautiful. There are many things that have progressed hugely.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's a huge mass of people who we really didn't make much
right.
difference to their lives. They're a little better off. But that's no consolation.
Yeah.
In comparison
to the time period.
Yes, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we are at an inflection point today where it has come to center stage around the world, not only in India, but India started even before the,
mm-hmm.
You know, like the new change in government, then the Brexit, and then the Trumps, and the, you know, there's a
correct.
There is an underlying unrest.
Yes, yeah.
Right?
And which is globally
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the Arab Spring, you know, this is so now. Point is, how sensitive are we to what has been left behind? So if you're going to start your life today, one eye should always be in what can you do to help you.
Right.
While you're pursuing what you're pursuing.
Yes.
But not with insensitivity.
Right.
If you are not sensitive to the environment, then you come to suffer it another day.
Yes.
If you don't, your children will.
Right. Right.
You know? Mm-hmm. So you take environment, you take the poor people, you take lack of facilities, of health facilities, education facilities. Mm-hmm. These are not nice things.
Yeah.
So you say, I am me, I'm doing very well, and I don't give a damn. You are actually writing the epitaph of your generations
to come. Exactly. Absolutely.
You get my point?
I agree with you.
So those are the few thoughts that I would like to share.
Share with the new, younger generation.
You know, there are two things about money.
Yeah.
You can't eat it. You can't take it. You can't take it with you.
With you, right.
And the more you make, the less you are allowed to eat. We are the ones who keep saying, "Eat less, eat less, eat less." So, what's the point?
Yeah, right.
I mean, how many golden beds can you sleep on?
Yeah.
It's all crazy. So we have gone crazy, and then you know, it's like saying 1% of the population owns 50% of the country's wealth.
Yes, right.
Now that is a very scary thought, and if it was going on without people being aware of it is one thing. Mm-hmm. Now it's front page mm-hmm. news.
Yes.
So what is the guy who's sitting there struggling to find for two meals, three meals for his family? What
yes.
is he thinking?
Yeah, true.
Is, you know, and it's happening. You're yeah. seeing the rumblings. The main thing is we didn't pay attention. It's time to do it double time today and try to settle the world.
Yeah.
And wherever environment you're in, whatever you can do individually,
your
is at least, you don't wait for the whole
yes,
world to take.
Yes. I'm going to ask you one personal question is, what would be your turning point in your life? Like one significant moment where if you reflect back and you think like, wow, that was the moment that changed me forever.
Well, I think the most significant, everlasting, even before I became a heart surgeon, was meeting my wife.
Okay.
So we were 16 years old, and I was like a typical young boy growing up in India, which is the most macho society there was at that
mm-hmm.
time. I mean, it's less now, but it's still there.
Yes.
And here was the person who I met who was totally sensitive, intelligently, you know, connected around the environment, and it was a great
yeah.
to and fro. So I think she has contributed hugely in my journey, hugely.
Yeah.
I mean, of course, taking care of kids and all that one thing. She's a well-known journalist
mm-hmm.
in her own right, and I think that has been like the turning moment is still continuing.
Yes.
Right? And the second turning moment
yes.
was when I went to the US. I first got a job in Philadelphia
mm-hmm.
while at Thomas Jefferson. I got the residency program, 5-year program. But that was the beginning of cardiac surgery.
Okay.
The drama.
Okay.
Yeah, the drama
yes.
of cardiac surgery
yes,
saw
right.
where people
open
we didn't
heart.
Even know if they'll survive.
Yeah,
yeah, open
right.
heart surgery started.
Mm-hmm.
So when I first saw it, in the first year that I was there, I asked my chief, I said, who's the best teacher of heart surgery? Because
mm-hmm.
I knew that people were dying in India.
Yes.
And there was nobody to save them. We didn't know any heart surgery.
Right.
So the chief said, his name was Dr. Goldsmith, he said, you know, Dr. Spencer at New York University, but why do you ask? He's got a 5-year waiting list and he doesn't speak to foreigners.
Yeah.
That one sentence went right through my heart. I said, how is that possible? I wrote to him. I went home and wrote to him and I said verbatim that this is what I was told, and it's a pity. Because I've come all the way from India, where people are dying. If I could learn the best heart surgery, I could go and serve them. So in a way, it was not a complimentary letter.
Yes, yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And he wrote back immediately. He said, no, it's not true. I speak to foreigners. No problem. So
there was...
At the risk of upsetting him, it was almost like saying it's bigotry. So the rest is history. He said, you're welcome. There's a one job. There are 32 residents. 31 are taken already. One job Thursday, this day, you're welcome to come in.
Oh, how nice.
You're welcome to take. So I got in, then I survived the pyramid because 32 started as first year, 4 you would finish as chief residents, then 2 would go to cardiac, and then fortunately after that I got appointed in the faculty.
Right.
So that was the second turning moment. If he had not said that word, that he doesn't speak to foreigners, I would not have written that letter in that tone, and I don't think I would have gotten any response, and rest is history.
Thank you for sharing. Fabulous. We call it Roshni moments, like turning point, Roshni moments.
So there are,
your
you can
life.
Say that. Yeah,
yes,
absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And I consider him my professional father, guru.
Mentor.
Absolutely. Yeah. No, that's a rebirth for me.
Yes. Thank you so much for your interview. And next year we are having Roshni Media Awards. I think, I'm not sure if you're seen the clips of previous ones in New York, and will follow up with your office for that.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Great. No, really.
Yes.
Thank you for coming again and
of
stay in touch.
Of course.